Hi, this is Dr. Gary Namy. You know, some people say to leave politics out of the WBI anti-bullying message. I would if I could, but I cannot. Put aside for a moment that one of the other hats I wear is directing a national network of volunteer state coordinators who work tirelessly to enact legislation in the states. And those state houses are chock full of politicians, a majority of whom we have to win over to pass our bill to make it a law. Now that's pure politics, but let's put that aside. In reality, the workplace itself is a political place. Bullying follows rank within the organization, and company politics determine alliances and cliques. But that's still not the main point of this podcast. We have an entire website and books that detail the intricacies of internal politics and how bullying is sustained. What I'm focusing here on right now are employee rights, the very few that Americans have remaining. Each right that allows a worker to speak up and be protected or to be free from harassment or discrimination is the product of a first federal law and then a state law. It's all about legislation. Employers didn't grant these rights to employees voluntarily. And if you don't have a union, you have only state and federal laws granting you the few rights. Would you think employers sat around in some chamber of commerce meeting over cookies and tea and said, "You know what? Men should stop grabbing women at work. We have determined that, and we don't want that to be." If anything, they'd want it to be. But no, it took federal laws, hard-fought, based on civil rights protests, bloody civil rights protests of decades, to get the federal government to say, okay, discrimination's really bad. And then and only then was there a law. You know, you might think human resources is apolitical, not political. Well, to tell the truth, it's political both inside the organization, because they pretend to be often the voice of employees. If they were honest with you, they'd tell all employees they're a management support function. They are seconds for the managers. And that's true. But also their trade association, SHRM, Society for Human Resources Management, opposes our anti-bullying legislation. They have a very active legislative wing and arm, and they go to the national capitol and the state houses and they protest against workers' rights bills, and they try and advance employers' rights. Employers have all the rights now, but they want more. And SHRM is on their side, not your side. You know, the steady erosion of workers' rights in the U.S. is a direct function of the long-standing political campaigns to undermine unions, specifically public sector unions. The week that I'm recording this podcast, the Labor Department announced the reduction to 11.2% of the American workforce that work in unions. 400,000 government jobs have been lost in the last year. That's because we allowed the states, counties, and cities to go broke in the name of austerity. Because we didn't fund them, workers were able to be cut. And sometimes, if the state wasn't broke, they cut workers anyway as an anti-public sector union move. Because it's in the public sector where the unions still have a presence. They're virtually non-existent, less than 7% in the private sector in the U.S. As government jobs are cut, union membership roles shrink. Republican governors and Republican-controlled legislatures have acted swiftly to cut union bargaining rights, first in Wisconsin, then Michigan, and it's spreading all over the country where that trifecta exists: Republican governor, Republican-controlled House, Republican-controlled Senate. This is a fact. I'm not making a partisan statement about this, but it is a partisan decision. Thanks to ALEC, the partisan group that educates Republicans and provides the draft language for these types of bills, there can be a national coordinated wave of anti-worker laws all put into place all at the same time. And those laws put teeth to the anti-worker rhetoric you hear in the media all the time. They've even turned you and me, the workers, against one another. They're trying to convince the American public unions are bad, workers' rights are bad, at a time of largesse for the corporations. But more about that at another time. Lest you think I'm partisan, because that's what people say, keep the politics out, I don't want your partisan politics, allow me to distribute some blame to the Democrats now. You know, they have longed to have overflowing re-election coffers. And when they chase big money funders, just like the Republicans, When they drink from the same tap, then they get equally drunk with the same money. They start to sound just like Republicans. And that explains why so many so-called new Democrats turn their backs on unions, workers, and the poor. It seems like the old Democratic ideal of considering the disadvantaged among us as constituents is lost. Now, those are my kind of politicians, so that's where I stand, if you want to know. Bully targets are the disadvantaged. They are the underdog. I'm always for the underdog. I don't care what stripe that politician comes in, what party, Republican or Democrat. If they're for the underdog, that's what we want. Now, an example of politics affecting daily workplace routines came up just today in the news. A 3-judge panel from the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit just ruled that President Obama's January 2012 appointments to the NLRB, National Labor Relations Board, are unconstitutional. For years, the 5-member NLRB was under Republican control and did not rule in favor of unions, especially under Republican-led administrations. They were able to work in concert with Republican lawmakers, stripping unions of parity with employers, piece by piece, chipping away at NLRB and National Labor Relations Act provided rights. Now, Obama sought Senate confirmation for his appointments, including a union lawyer named Richard Griffin. Senate Republicans blocked his nominations. Seats went unfilled. So when the Senate was on holiday recess, the Christmas New Year's 2011, early 2012 span, Obama made the appointments. Now, it sounds sneaky, but all presidents use recess appointments. Recall that George W. Bush installed United Nations hater John Bolton as the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. That was a recess appointment. Now, a bit of history. The National Labor Relations Board was created by the National Labor Relations Act in 1935, often known as the Wagner Act, and it gave workers good rights to unionize. They had been denied many rights prior to that, and many had been killed organizing unions, and this made it easier to unionize. Then World War II happened, and the time of great industrial armaments production, but unions could not strike during the war. Right after the war, 1945 through 1946, unions across the country launched several hundred strikes. This angered Republicans, and then they gained control of the U.S. Congress in the House and the Senate, and they passed what is called the 1947 Taft-Hartley Act, and that severely restricted union activity. So unions had a heyday for 11 to 12 years, technically. Now, President Truman vetoed the bill, but the Republicans had sufficient votes to override his veto and it became the law of the land. Now, back in 1912, the NLRB, the child of the original pro-union Wagner Act, with the recess appointments from President Obama, returned to its roots and its mission to make more decisions that favored workers. It restored balance between employers and workers benefited more. If the appellate court decision today to strike down those recess appointments stands, all of the 2012 pro-worker rulings will become invalid. Actually, all of their rulings, period, of the NLRB will become invalid. The administration is going to have to appeal to the most pro-corporate U.S. Supreme Court in history. I haven't heard yet. They'll have to announce whether they choose to appeal to the Supreme Court, but that could be a tough road there too. So there you have it. Politicians in the courts, reliant upon the foundations of partisan politics, are the people who determine who can do what in your workplace. Your rights are politically driven. You cannot separate the workplace from politics. Politics, left unchecked, govern workplace rules. And without limits on employers, workers endure increasingly invasive surveillance, distrust, and once unthinkable indignities. Bullying's not even on the radar for most employers. To them, it's simply management as usual until told otherwise. And since the Supreme Court decision, the Citizens United decision, corporations, the purveyors of bullying, can support with cash the election of employer-friendly, anti-worker politicians who promise to pass anti-worker laws. Hey, I didn't make these new rules. The courts did. So you see, the campaign to stop workplace bullying is necessarily political, even when not discussing getting a bill passed. Politicians will eventually be the only ones who can curb employers. And only when employers are threatened with bullying-specific litigation that comes from having a law in place, something that's currently not available to workers now. Only then will employers even give bullying the serious attention it deserves. That's why there has to be a state law. But getting a worker protection law passed in this era is especially tough because of, wait for it, politics. Politics and workplace bullying are two inseparable phenomena. To believe otherwise is naive. Sweet and innocent, though disbelievers may be, they risk suffering disastrous consequences. Please visit the Workplace Bullying Institute website at workplacebullying.org.